And talking about dance, what do you think it's so radical on dance and dancing or the power of the art of dancing?
But dance is the mother of all arts, and it is radical. It is the radice, it is the root, because everything that we do is rooted in the body. So it's not that, that's why dance doesn't have to be the supreme like that. It is the earthy ordinariness, the literal root. Although we are not rooted like trees, our body is constantly in the situation of touching the floor, or touching something that's touching the floor on a very obvious level. And that means that we dare to listen to that which is rooted beyond us into the ground. Now that's radical, that's political, because it's not based on an intellectual idea, it's not based on an idealism, it's not based on a philosophy, you could say. And that's, I think, one of the great beauties of it, and one of the reasons why it's so influencing and also often so swept aside in the arts, because it is so radical. And of course, this brings up lots of issues in our societies about body permission, about taboo, about the autonomy of the body, about the feminine nature of the body, whether male or female, about the receptivity. Yes, the feminine principle, you could say, is so clear in the earthiness of the body. And so that's a very big issue.
And today people use a lot of word authenticity. What do you think about this word, authenticity?
Oh, me, and just go back into the dictionary. Authenticity comes from author. Author means you just sign for it.
Must.
Because it's authentic, it's not authentic. It's like honesty. On one level, we can get in a big mess when we tickle those words. Is it authentic? Is it not?
Mm.
It's authentic. Something's authentic because you signed for it. You say, I'm the author of it. Well, I think there are many more interesting things to talk about, or definitions. And often I feel, when people say that, there's a lot of cultural value judgment going on, which doesn't interest me at all. Theatre aims to dissolve those differences so we can actually see them rather than support them, so they become lots of different fields that we can play off each other, you know.
Also, you talk about self-expression. Why we are so in this kind of self-expressive stuff when we dancing. Is it something you can also describe more?
How can I say? My friend Svante Grogan, a wonderful theatre director and writer, we were talking one time and he said, ah, Julyen, it's very clear. Therapy, theatre. And in that sense, the wonders and the beauty of self-expression is so important to the individual in their youth, in their adolescence, in any stage of their life. This being able to express yourself is something of a great animal and human richness. And yes, great. When it comes to theatre, I think we're given a chance as individuals to not just be bounded by our self-expression, but by the expression of things which are not beyond us, but are not just about our own experience. They come through ourselves, of course, but that doesn't mean to say that they are about ourselves.
And you've been talking also about radial and linear time.
Yes.
So could you explain more?
In my understanding of how we've lived as humans, our perception of time, there's probably many, many different perceptions of time. And the more I read about different societies, the more I realize that there's each society very subtly but very specifically has a different way of living in time. Maybe so different that if you're not from that society, you can't understand it, except maybe just on an intellectual level, maybe. But is it fine? But the two areas that I found useful in terms of working in the theater is the radial time, which is this nearly timeless sense of everything all being present all the time, everywhere, this huge expansion that everything is happening and allowed to be perceived now. And I know that we've lived like that for hundreds and hundreds, thousands of years as humans. Yes, we've noticed the seasons in a linear way, but it's always being. It's always being, whether it was being 100 years ago or being 100 years time, it's always full of being now. It's very difficult to put these into words because usually and probably when you listen to this, you're listening to it with a mind that is conceiving in linear time. But all of us have had the experience, maybe only for a second, of it just being all there. And even though it takes linear time, it's all being there during that. Moments of happiness, moments of spending an evening with friends, and you don't notice the time passing. And it's not because you're dizzy or drunk or have a distorted awareness. No, there's another level of time which comes in. Now that time, that radial time, is probably where we've spent most of our time as human beings. And it's only the last few hundred years where we've really accented and put an importance and a superior importance on this linear time. And in the theater, although it takes place, and the cinema, although it takes place in linear time, the sensations and the temporality which is offered you is not just in linear time. This is why we're touched by Tarkovsky. This is why we're touched by different editors, because although they know they're playing the deal of linear time, what actually is being offered is a radial perception of time.
So you can say that to improvise or to do instant composition, it's also kind of a technique you have to develop?
Every creative moment is improvised. Even if you read the same script 10 times, each time you read it, it's improvised. And if you've ever tried in recording the voice to say the second half of a sentence and stick it on because of a mistake, you realize how individual and creative every single sentence is. It's all improvising. It's all improvising. It's just a case of how much you dedicate yourself to the creativity which comes up with that spontaneity. And some people are good at monitoring that and adjusting it over a year, 2 years, 10 years. And some people are good at it coming out at a high level of pertinence, of specificity, of emotion, of directness, of sharing. And for that, you learn those things, you practice those things, and that's the technique. That's the technique. I have a very simple take on what is technique. It's basically, how does it work, and can I do it?
And the relationship with music, we discuss a lot today.
Yes. Dance has always gone with music. Recently, music has played on its own for a little bit in the Western society. But the history of it is that in most societies, whenever there was music, there was dance. Dance, music went with dance. Recently, we actually have musicians that don't have dancers there. In fact, we're so used to that recently that it becomes like, oh, you put dance with the music. Well, it always was. And that's why many of the terms in music actually come from dancing. It's body. So they go together, they live together, they've developed together. Dance is musical and music is physical. They come from the same source. They come from the same, the body that does this with the bow is the same as the body that does this move. Even if you're playing the electronics, the guys who do all the electronics, they want to move from the chair. You understand it? So that at base, it's all movement. One level goes into the poetry of the body dancing, and the other goes into the poetry of sound being made. And they resound and they live, both of them, in space. That's where we meet. But of course, one of the great powers of dancing is its earthiness. And one of the great powers of music is its celestial, ethereal. So there's also, while they might come through the body, they vibrate and they touch different parts of us. And without generalizing or too much or being reductive, music appeals to that ether, that spirit in us, not only, but it's excellent at that. And the body appeals to that earthiness, that connectedness to the earth. Which is not to say that dance doesn't have a spiritual vibration and that music doesn't have an earthy, no, not at all. But when they go together, sometimes you have these two levels of our experience resounding. Wow, well, that's a very great poem. I mean, that's exciting. Because they are cohabiting the two deep elements of humanness, which is what it's like to be here in the body and what's going on with the spirit, with another level of our perception. So when you have those, when you have experts or people who are fascinated by these two zones and they play together, they listen to each other, of course that's a huge, huge cohabitation of power.
My last question about this workshop, if you work with students or participants, what is important for you to share with them? What is your philosophy about teaching or to be pedagogue?
So I think that's my privilege when teaching, is that I love to see people's creativity, and I use any method to let that happen. And over the years, because I've been teaching quite a long time, I've allowed myself different permissions. And how I've gone about doing that has changed with each decade, which seems perfectly normal, actually, because we perceive differently at different times, and we perceive strongly at certain times. So if one has something that is always only the same, it doesn't gain from that very strong insight you have in your 40s or in your 20s or in your 60s, where it's like you're specialized in seeing things in that way, and that's what you bring at that time. And when you're in another decade, you bring that. So I don't have one pedagogy, you could say, in that way. I give myself the permission to go very intuitively. And the other thing that happens to me is I don't want to say I see people's future, but when I watch people moving, I can sense some developed, evolved nature in them. I just see it. sometimes I see it so strongly that I can hardly see the reality of the moment. So I have to work at seeing that reality because I can see what they're becoming. I sense what they're becoming. And so I always attend to that in one way or another. Invite them there, stimulate them there, go there myself and say, come on over. And I don't know what that ability quite is, but I've noticed it. It's just there, I suppose.